today is our final opening session for our Scottish Attainment Challenge Inquiry, and I'd like to welcome to the committee room and to the committee Shirley Ann Somerville, MSP, Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills, Graham Logan, Director of Learning, and Alison Taylor, Deputy Director for Improvement, Attainment and Wellbeing, Scottish Government. And good morning to you all. Cabinet Secretary, I'd like to welcome you.
Thank you very much. Good morning, convener. It's a real pleasure to be here in your final evidence session, and I've obviously followed the committee's inquiry very closely to date, quite rightly, given the prominence we all place on tackling the poverty-related attainment gap. You've placed a great deal of importance on ensuring you've canvassed the views and engaged with organisations and individuals from across the sector. And I've been pleased to hear the views on what's working well and obviously what we can improve on too. Since being appointed to the role of Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills, it has been a real privilege to work with the education workforce and to see the dedication of that workforce under the most difficult of circumstances. I recognise and appreciate the immense efforts that they have taken to ensure our children and young people are given the best care, support and opportunities to achieve their full potential, regardless of their background. I know you too have been struck by the exceptional efforts and good practice taking place in our schools. There is a strong body of evidence that the programme is having a positive impact. The great majority of headteachers, 96%, who responded to the SF headteacher survey, felt that they had a good awareness of the range of approaches that can help close the poverty-related attainment gap, while 93% felt confident about selecting the approach most effective for their school. So I think we can all, and I include myself in that, do more to celebrate what has been achieved. I know too, though, that we all share a determination to intensify the efforts to close the poverty-related attainment gap and to tackle any variation in the outcomes achieved by children in different parts of the country. We expect and need to see results on that. That's why I am committed to working with everyone in education and beyond, including, of course, this committee, to accelerate efforts to achieve excellence and equity for Scotland's children and young people. As we seek to create a more cohesive, simplified and consistent education system to continue delivering excellence and equity for Scotland's learners, we can build on the work that is already being undertaken, as well as the important principles that are set out in Professor Muir's recent report. My appearance here is timely, following the successful launch of the Refresh Scottish Attainment Challenge programme at the end of March. Like the committee's wide engagement as this part of this inquiry, we have drawn upon a wide range of evidence and valuable engagement with a range of stakeholders to help refresh the programme. Reflecting on the evidence, some key considerations were drawn upon in developing the Refresh programme. Progress in tackling the poverty-related attainment gap was made before the pandemic. This, alongside the learning through the programme to date, provides a solid foundation on which we can seek to accelerate both recovery and process. We recognise the need to make quicker progress, even in relation to pre-pandemic gains, and to tackle variation in outcomes between and within local authority areas. There is a need to address the negative impact of COVID-19 on children's health, wellbeing and learning. Improving leadership, learning and teaching, and the quality of support for families and communities, and targeted support for those impacted by poverty, remain the key levers to improve outcomes for children and young people. In refreshing the programme, there's an opportunity to reinforce our collective commitment to equity in education, mitigate the impact of poverty on children's outcomes and tackle the attainment gap. This is evident in the mission of the Refresh Challenge, to use education to improve outcomes for children and young people impacted by poverty, with a focus on tackling the poverty-related attainment gap. This mission gives greater focus on outcomes and everything that underpins positive outcomes for children and young people, including their health and well-being, their wider achievements and experiences, as well as their academic attainment. The new framework for recovery and accelerating progress will underpin the ambition of the refreshed mission and has been developed to reinforce our collective commitment to equity in education and set high expectations, including ambitious locally identified stretch aims. All of this is backed by an increased £1 billion additional investment, which is empowering local authorities and our headteachers who know their children best. This includes the commitment of over £520 million of pupil equity funding over 4 years, empowering our headteachers and allowing them to plan over short and longer terms. But we know schools can't do this alone. So in recognition that poverty exists in all local authorities, funding will now go direct to each and every local authority for the very first time, supporting them to develop strategic approaches to working with schools, wider local authority services and national community partners. Stretch aims will be developed by each local authority, so we will know how much progress is expected and by when, with an offer to provide tailored support and challenge through Education Scotland and the Regional Improvement Collaboratives. This approach was developed and agreed with partners, including local government and headteachers. Multi-year allocations confirmed over a four-year period will also allow local authorities to plan for the longer term. The refreshed programme will also provide continued additional support for care experienced children and young people through the Care Experienced Children and Young People Fund. There are also a number of national programmes, including a number of third sector organisations who will also be supported. I'd like to close by stressing that nothing is more important than ensuring every child and young person has the same opportunity to exceed in education regardless of their background. And I believe the Refresh Scottish Attainment Challenge will help to deliver this for them. But as the challenges of the pandemic and the cost of living crisis continues, and as some evidence to date shows, we know that there is more to do. I'm very pleased to be able to take part in the discussion in the debate with the committee on how we do just that. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Let me begin the questioning this morning then with a very simple question. Is it still your plan to close the attainment gap? And when will we see improvement to the extent that that gap has been closed?
Well, I think one of the important aspects that we've looked at as we've refreshed our Scottish Attainment Challenge is the stretch aims. And I would point to that as an important development that we have seen. I'm not going to set an arbitrary date on when the attainment gap will be closed, particularly so close to the experiences that we are still having with the pandemic. And we know that the pandemic has had an impact on attainment. But what we have... what we very much intend to do through the stretch aims and through working with local authorities is for local authorities to be able to determine what can be done in their area and what support is required from our national agencies to be able to support them to do so.
You say the local authorities, in your statement you mentioned local authorities having stretch aims or targets, let's call them targets. What's the government's stretch target for this fund then? If you're not prepared to commit to timetabling or signposting. And by the way, Audit Scotland did specifically say that in relation to this fund, I quote, the Scottish Government needs to be clearer about the anticipated pace of change, identify and measure against appropriate milestones, and consider the lessons about what works in determining how funding is directed. But what you seem to be saying is that you're not prepared to say any of that. You're not prepared to give any milestones. You're not prepared to give any measurements.
Well, I think there are two approaches that you can have with this type of work. You can do it in a top-down approach, sitting in St Andrew's House, where I dictate a policy and then a target. Or you can work with local government, who have the responsibility to deliver education, so that we are working in partnership, national and local government, for the local government to be able to set the aims that are correct for their area. And there will be a difference in different local authority aims that they come through. So I prefer not to have a top-down approach to this. I prefer to work with local government. Of course, our ambition is no less than to close the attainment gap. But we do need to recognise that that is a long-term endeavour. Indeed,
what does long-term mean?
Well, you quoted Audit Scotland there, Convener, and they themselves have said that reducing the poverty-related attainment gap is a complex challenge and will take time. And it will take time to deliver the reductions in the poverty-related attainment gap. But we are determined to see a greater pace of progress than we were before the pandemic. And that's what the stretch aims are an important part of.
But I'm not asking you to dictate to anybody or anything, but you have a responsibility. You've got, you know, we're spending £200 million a year on this. You have a responsibility to set out what your expectation is about what outcomes we expect. So, I mean, in terms of stretch aims, what is your expectation in relation to closing the poverty-related attainment gap? This year, next 5 years, whatever it is, it would be very helpful to the committee and I think to the public at large, and certainly to Audit Scotland, if you would be more specific.
Well, I think I would hope when Audit Scotland come to review this process again, as I'm sure they are will, they will. I think they hope. Well, I hope they will appreciate the fact that we are working with local government in this area. So we are collating, obviously, the local aims, and that will help us provide a picture of what will happen.
But what about
nationally.
Setting expectations? What are your expectations in relation to closing the attainment gap?
My expectations is that every single local authority will work with Education Scotland as they deliver their stretch aims for them to be as challenging as possible. Those will differ.
But none of that's very measurable, is it, Cabinet Secretary? That's the problem.
With the greatest respect, Convener, it will be measurable once the local authorities have developed their stretch aims, which my understanding is that they will be developed by September for the new academic year. Has begun. They are very accountable, they will be very obvious, and they will be very measurable, and we will be able to measure the progress in that. So I think
and they will be published?
Well, what I'm very, very clear about is that we need to see more transparency in this area. I think we have listened as a national government to what Audit Scotland said in this area. So once the data is in a state to be able to be published, once we've collated all that data from the local authorities, then I absolutely see no reason for that. But I would actually, of course, expect local authorities to be able to publish that data as and when they stretch their stretch aims, because it's part of their local improvement work. So this shouldn't be a secretive manner of development, either at a local level or indeed at a national level. So yes, we will absolutely make sure that material will be published to allow people to be able to see what's happening locally and to see what's happening at a national level.
The framework does stipulate that your responsibility is to collect data. So when will the Scottish Government be publishing this data that you're describing?
So the stretch aims need to be in by September for local authorities. Well, obviously, once those are collated and we are ensuring that we have the correct information from local authorities, I would like to publish very soon after that.
OK. I'm going to bring in Graham. Graham Day.
Can come to this from a slightly different direction, Cabinet Secretary, and perhaps get an answer, a more detailed answer, and always need the point the convener is making. If we approach this from the bottom up, teachers that we've spoken to in our evidence gathering have been very clear about, firstly, the impact of the pandemic has been significant, so we have to recognise that, and we also have the cost of living crisis. But they've also acknowledged that they now have a much clearer idea of what works in terms of addressing the attainment challenge. So if we have that, we have the funding in place and the government providing direction, looking at all that in the round, would it be reasonable to expect that in the coming years, the next few years, we will begin to see further and quite significant progress being made if those foundations are in place?
I think we would expect to see significant progress in this. The challenge, of course, we have is by coming out of COVID, the progress that was being made pre-pandemic, it has been impacted by COVID. So that is, as teachers are doing day in, day out, to be able to support children and young people through the impact of COVID. But the entire purpose of having the refresh and making the changes that we have is that we not only expect to see progress, but we would expect to see accelerated progress from what we did at pre-pandemic levels.
Thank you.
How much money has been spent so far in the Attainment Scotland Fund? How much has already been spent?
So in total, in the previous parliamentary term, we had £750 million spent on the Attainment Challenge, and this parliamentary term, it's £1 billion.
So far, with 1 year of this parliament in, it's about £1 billion.
Approximately, yes.
Yeah. So, do you know how this money has been spent?
Well, yes. The money obviously is allocated to local authorities or directly to schools.
Yes.
What we've also made sure through the work with Education Scotland is that Education Scotland has been working with local government and with schools to be able to see the best practice about how that money has been spent, the projects that have worked.
But can you publish how that money has been spent? Can you give a full accounting to Parliament and to the country as to how £1 billion has been spent? Can you give an accounting for that?
Well, the figures are there for what goes to local government.
No, no, what it has been spent on, not how much has been allocated, but what it's been spent on.
So each individual school will, of course, determine, for example, how the PEF money has been spent. We don't collate the database for every single school and every single project.
So is it fair to say you don't know how that money has been spent?
It's up to individual schools to be able to determine the programmes that they have.
Yes.
And then Education Scotland have, of course, worked with schools to be able to collate information. I don't have to hand the information about, obviously, how each individual school has spent their money, but it's for Education Scotland to be able to link with the schools to determine how they've spent the money and also to be able to work out what's worked and what hasn't worked. But what we are keen to do in this new refreshed attainment challenge is to have more of a link actually between the local authority and the school so that they are collating also the information about how money's been spent.
Do you think it's unfair of me to say if you don't know how £1 billion has been spent, because that's effectively what your answer is, how can you measure whether it's been effectively spent in terms of outcomes?
Well, I don't have the information to hand today, Convener. But
that's what this is all about. That's what this session is all about.
Well, I don't have the information to hand. I don't think the committee would expect me to have how every single school has spent their money as I sit in front of committee.
That's but not what I'm asking,
but what we absolutely have is the school and local authority plans and reports. They are a condition of the grant. So what I'm again saying is for Education Scotland, we would be happy to provide further advice after this, but it's the condition of grant to be able to ensure that the schools or the local authority are working with Education Scotland on the projects and also, importantly, having the discussion about what's worked and what's had the greatest impact.
Yes.
We, of course, also then have the annual evaluation reports that look at a range of different expenditure. But it is part of our empowerment agenda to empower head teachers to determine how to spend money. And then, of course, our agencies are there to assist them to ensure that the money is being spent effectively and that other schools are learning from that.
And that's fair enough, but you still have an accountability for £1 billion of public money and how it's spent and what the outcomes are for that spending. And I don't think you're... I don't detect that you're shirking that responsibility, and you, I think, have said in your answers to my questions that you're going to provide us with more written detail as to what that money has been spent on.
We absolutely would be happy to provide the further information about the relationship between Education Scotland, local authorities and schools, and how the money is spent. But I don't have that detail.
Because we all want that money to produce the outcome that we all want, which is that the attainment gap is narrowed, that attainment in general rises, and that gap, particularly the poverty-related gap, is closed. We all want that, so we need to see that happening with the commitment that the Scottish taxpayers made of £1 billion in that direction. One last very quick question before I pass on to the Deputy Convener. You meet, in the time that you've been the Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills, you haven't had a meeting with Education Scotland to discuss the detail of what is happening in terms of this money and the progress that's being made or the measurements that need to be provided. That's correct, isn't it? You've not had a meeting where you've discussed that yet.
I meet Education Scotland on a regular basis at different levels within the organisation to discuss a wide variety of views. I'm sure, as the committee would expect, the Scottish Attainment Challenge comes up very regularly during those discussions, both the use of the previous funding, the development of the refresh funding and how that's going to develop. So I meet Education Scotland on an exceptionally regular basis.
Education Scotland said they had had one meeting with you to discuss in the measurement of this money and the progress that's been made. And that was a meeting to discuss process rather than the actual... Yes?
So what we've had, obviously, within the refreshed work that we've had, there's been a meeting to discuss the process for the refreshed work for this. This is the quarterly meetings that I will have with Education Scotland to discuss the refreshed work that's happening. But of course, I have met Education Scotland on numerous...
But were they the specific purpose of these meetings, which is the focus of our inquiry, but these meetings weren't happening before now. That's what I'm saying.
They were happening in a different guise and in different areas. So what we've tried to do is make sure that we have a specific meeting to go over aspects of this. But they won't be the only meetings I will have with Education Scotland.
That's the focus of this particular meeting. The minutes of the last meeting that you held, where this was the focus of the discussion, are those published? Are the presentations shared?
I'm not aware if they are published, but we'd be happy to ensure that minutes of the quarterly meetings are provided and on an ongoing basis.
Okay.
But I
would
again stress that is one meeting amongst many I have with Education Scotland to discuss the Scottish Attainment Challenge Fund.
I appreciate that, but it's this meeting that's focused on this specific area that we're inquiring into. If those minutes are available in terms of the data and the measurements and all the stuff that we're really interested in, that would be fantastic. We look forward to that. Deputy Convener.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, everyone. It's been a fascinating discussion so far. Can I? I'm just going to refer a wee bit to, obviously, you acknowledge that we've taken extensive evidence over the last sort of months on this, and parents, young people and teachers were saying that prior to COVID there was progress that was being made regarding closing the attainment gap, albeit modest, but nevertheless we were moving in the right direction. And I mean, it's inevitable to anybody, it's stark to, you know, it's very clear that COVID has had an impact on that. So could the Cabinet Secretary please just sort of briefly, I know we don't have a huge amount of time, what progress do you, you know, the highlights of the progress that you think has been made in closing the poverty-related attainment gap? And has the Scottish Government considered widening the definitions of measuring that attainment?
Clearly, as I think I've said already, the pandemic has had an impact on the progress that was being made. But when we look at the pre-pandemic figures, for example, the year-on-year trend in the ASIL data that is published was positive. We saw in the two-year period between 16-17 and 18-19, the proportions of primary school pupils achieving expected levels in literacy increased by 3.1 percentage points, and it rose 2.7% for numeracy. In this period, the gaps between the proportion of primary schools from the most and least deprived areas who achieved their expected level in literacy and numeracy had both reduced. So while we had seen progress in this, and while of course we continue to see very good statistics for those that are leaving school and going on to positive destinations, indeed they are now at a record level, obviously we are keen to see further progress and more accelerated progress than that.
Sort of like you're, I mean, obviously it's a complex area. I know that from teaching within for many years, is that it's not just about education. When you're looking at the poverty related, the poverty bit sometimes gets sort of taken off that. So how does the Scottish Government challenge fit into the Scottish Government's overall approach to tackling child poverty? Because inevitably one sort of aspect has, you know, if people don't have enough money, for instance, if parents don't, and a child is not ready to learn because they're hungry, that makes it even more challenging for teachers as well. So the two things go together. So as I said, just to repeat for you, how does the how does the Scottish Attainment Challenge fit into the Scottish Government's overall plan?
So I mentioned in my introductory remarks, of course, that we had changed the mission of the Scottish Attainment Challenge programme, and that was very clearly to draw further focus to the fact that, well, we can do a lot within education to be able to improve outcomes for children and young people. We are exceptionally aware of the fact that poverty is not something that can be solved between the hours of 9 and 3 when a child is in school, but actually what happens out with that is exceptionally important as well. That's why we're very keen to ensure that there is a very specific link between the education work and, for example, the work that's happening in the Tackle Child Poverty Delivery Plan around the increases to Scottish Child Payment, the work that's being done to take account of the cost of the school day, increasing to school clothing grants, for example, ability for children and young people to take any subject without having to receive charges for those, and core curriculum charges, music charges, etc. So we're very, very determined to ensure that the education and anti-poverty work is linked very specifically. That is made more difficult when we have, of course, the cost of living crisis, and we have the impact also of policies that are happening elsewhere in the UK and dictated to by the UK government that is impacting on poverty levels too. But certainly within what we have the ability to control up here, we're very keen to make sure that there is a very express link between what's happening within education and what's happening in the wider anti-poverty work.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much. Willie Rennie.
Thanks, Cabinet Secretary. I'm interested in how we got here. What's your assessment as to why the poverty-related attainment gap was so wide and why we got such a critical report from the OECD back in 2015? What are the root causes of that?
Well, I think the poverty-related attainment gap is something that you'll see across many different countries. It's not something that's specific to Scotland. We see those same challenges happening elsewhere in the UK or indeed further afield. What we have seen in Scotland is a determination to be able to tackle that.
I don't want to go into what's next. I want to focus on how we got here. And you've addressed the fact that it happens elsewhere. But what I want to know is why it happened here, but also why the rest of the OECD report that covered a whole lot of other areas as well in terms of education was so critical. Do we understand how we got here?
Well, I think the OECD reports that we have had over a number of years have continued to say, well, there is, of course, room for improvement within Scottish education, that we do have a good foundation for Scottish education. I will push back on the OECD are critical of Scottish education, because I don't think that's a fair
sections.
Reflection of actually the fact that they have produced reports that have endorsed curriculum for excellence. They have encouraged us to develop the way. I think it's very important that I push back on the OECD being critical.
But we're in politics to try and improve things, aren't we? That's why we're here. So if we just keep on going on about the positive things, we're not going to make any progress. We need to identify why things were going wrong in many areas that the OECD did highlight. Do you understand what those things are?
Well, there was a number of areas that the OECD have suggested that we've looked at over the years. One of them was about strengthening the middle, as it was paraphrased, and that was therefore one of the reasons why we looked at regional improvement collaboratives, more collaborative workings between local authorities. There's also been a discussion about the empowerment of our teaching workforce to ensure that we have a workforce that is empowered and enabled to be able to take decisions that's right for their school. And I think that's been an important change that we've had. So some of the reasons why we may have had difficulties in the past is not just the levels of poverty in the country, but also because perhaps we needed to ensure that there was more power being put to local authorities, more power being put to individual head teachers, and work that was going on to collaborate on that.
See, I mean, the reason why I'm asking this question is I've never heard any government minister explain what went wrong. They always leap immediately to apparent solutions, and quite radical solutions in some areas. It's quite a departure from past practice to have significant funds invested in the poverty-related attainment gap. But nobody's ever explained to me what went wrong in the first place. And you have not been able to do it today. You've immediately leapt towards solutions. So I don't think we're going to make any progress on this. But I would like the Minister to reflect on that, because I think we do need to understand what went wrong if we're going to fix it.
Well, with respect, I think I have said that poverty is one of the key challenges that we have in Scotland, as we have in other countries, and how we have had a system that has perhaps been too top-down and not actually allowed an empowered workforce to be able to take decisions that's right for them is one of the lessons that we've had to learn. So I think if we're looking at what we needed to improve on, both from the OECD and 2015, and again their further encouragement in their latest report, it's about ensuring that we're empowering a system and providing resources to that empowered system.
I just want to challenge your claim that things were getting better before the pandemic. I mean, on a number of indicators that I've looked at, the gap has widened. In terms of S3 literacy, widened from 13.6 to 13.8 between 16 and 18. level 4 of the SEQF widened from 6.5 to 7.1 between 2018 and 2019. Level 6 widened from 35 to 36 points in 2018-19. And so that was all before the pandemic. So why do you say things got better?
Because of the statistics that I read out earlier on. And what I would say was we knew that we were making an impact because of the statistics that I read out to the member earlier on. But we knew that we had to do more, and we knew there were areas we still needed to improve on, which is exactly why we've had the refresh. So I certainly won't sit here and say that everything before the pre-pandemic was going at the pace or the urgency that we would have liked, which is exactly why we've refreshed the system.
But it was going backwards. It wasn't as if more progress needed to be made. Progress wasn't being made in the indicators that I've just listed there. So why are you just selectively quoting the ones that perhaps have got... And I have to say, it's not big improvements, it's tiny margins. I mean, there's still a big poverty-related attainment gap of 35 points at level 6. So it's these gaps are enormous, and we're making infinitesimal improvements. If we're going to spend £1 billion, surely you'd expect something a bit better than this.
Well, I think we are seeing improvements in key areas, or we were pre-pandemic. And I think what we've also seen with the evaluation of the Scottish Attainment Challenge in general was that good progress was being made. We, for example, now have a much more empowered system where headteachers are much more knowledgeable and able to be able to pick projects that work correctly for their schools and that they feel that they can therefore determine what's driven in that school. So we know that there was progress made in areas. We know that there is more to do. But I would point out again to not just the five-year evaluation report showing good progress, but the fact that we have a record high proportion of school leavers entering positive destinations upon leaving school. So while I absolutely accept there is more to do, I would say that when we look at the school leaver destinations, for example, when we look at the ASO stats that I read out earlier on, yes, there is progress, but it needs to be accelerated.
Yeah, I would dispute that there's progress in the way that you described, and I think we do need to be honest about how much progress we're making, because it was claimed initially that we're going to close the poverty-related attainment gap completely. And I've heard ministers kind of roll back a little bit on the completely bit of it, saying it might not be possible to close it altogether. And the First Minister used to say it was, you know, had guiding mission or top priority. We don't hear her saying much about it anymore. And now we also hear that it's a very long-term project. So I just get a feeling that ministers are kind of backing off how much progress we're going to be making on that. Now, tell me that's not the case, because I want
it's
to...
It's not the case.
Definitely not the case, because I would like to hear, I would like to hear us getting more definitive targets, which you were unable to give the convener earlier on, and I would like us to be making more progress rather than dressing up stagnation as progress. So can you give me that assurance that that's going to happen?
You will see information about the stretch aims. Now, I'm not going to make any apologies for the fact that as the Cabinet Secretary for Education, I am working with local government to allow them to be able to develop stretch aims being supported by our national agencies. I would have hoped, given commitment to local government and empowering local government, you would actually, I think the committee would be pleased that we're not dictating from the centre, but we're actually working with local government to deliver the stretch aims, which will be publicly available, but we're working together with people. I'm not sure the last time the First Minister was ever asked the question, is it her defining mission? But it is absolutely the defining mission of this government to close the poverty-related attainment gap. It has always been a long-term process. This project was made very clear right from the start. And as have OECD, Audit Scotland, have again been very clear that it's always going to be a long-term project. But we will and are determined to see more accelerated progress.
OK, so one final question, Convener. Round about the PEF funding, if we had kept up with inflation from when the PEF funding, Pupil Equity Fund, was introduced, it would now be worth £130 million. Inflation today is up at 9%, could be much higher than that, but we've not got a commitment from government to raise it higher than the £120 million that it's currently set. Sorry, it was set at 120 and it's now 127. So we've not had any guarantee that it's going to be rising with inflation over the next period. And why isn't it being guaranteed to increase?
Well, what we've guaranteed is that there'll be £1 billion worth of expenditure over this parliamentary term in the Scottish Attainment Challenge. What we've got for the first time are long-term commitments from the government, which was a key ask of both local government and head teachers, that it wasn't year-on-year funding, but that it was guaranteed funding. And that's exactly what we've done. So there is £520 million of pupil equity funding that will be distributed to schools, and that is providing further certainty. We've also provided an uplift in the PEF per pupil this year as well. So I think what we have seen is a recognition of the fact there needs to be a long-term commitment to this. That's what the government has done, that we've guaranteed the funding that will be there for the next 4 years.
But it's not as valuable as it was when it was first introduced, because it should be 130 and it's short of that. And there's no guarantee it's going to increase with inflation when inflation is going through the roof. Surely we should be trying to give some guarantees that this is a top priority and therefore will be index linked.
Well, again, I would point to the fact that we've actually seen an uplift in PEF per pupil number that is given to local authorities.
But not with inflation.
But this year, we've established that. We've guaranteed the £1 billion worth of expenditure over the parliamentary term. There is, of course, a process that we will go through on an annual basis that will look at educational funding in addition to what happens within the Scottish Attainment Challenge. But this is the area where we have been able to guarantee funding in the long term, and that's been welcomed by local authorities and by headteachers.
OK, thanks.
Ruth McGuire.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. My questions were around the role of local authorities and some of the variation. Quite a bit of that has been covered perhaps in your interactions with the convener in terms of the role of local authorities in the revised approach. Obviously now money is going to all 32 local authorities, they're getting multi-year funding. Can I ask what duties are being placed on local authorities in this regard in terms of accountability?
Well, it is an important change that we've made in recognition that poverty exists in every area of Scotland, and it is very important that we look at the role of local authorities and work with local authorities to be able to provide them with additional support to undertake the work that they are doing. We do recognise within national government that we see variation within local authorities and between local authorities. One of the reasons behind the introduction of the stretch aims is to attempt to tackle the unwarranted variation that we have between local authorities and the hope that transparent mechanism that we're putting into the system gives a clear understanding of the local ambitions that we have. We're very clear that we need to really, really reduce that unwarranted variation, and there will be a constructive challenge and support going to all local authorities to ensure that they are ambitious in what they are developing. And we'll, of course, do that through the support of Education Scotland. But we do know there is variation in outcomes between local authorities. It's often talked about. I think the work that local authorities are doing through, for example, the collaborative work they're working on Education Scotland will assist with some of that. But we know that we've got more to do to be able to tackle that.
Thank you. You mentioned Education Scotland. They're providing constructive challenge to local authorities. I wonder if you can say a little bit more about that, I guess, because we all look for sort of simple answers and perhaps look for a uniformed approach across things because it can be easier to measure. We need to have local variation, but also have that challenge where things are not successful. So can you say a bit more about the actual mechanism of that?
Yes, so I should be clear that we're not wanting to stop local variation in how schools develop policies and in the way that they tackle the attainment gap, but what we are concerned about is the variation in outcomes at the end of the day. So we're certainly not looking at a one-size-fits-all. But within Education Scotland, there is obviously a great deal of work to provide universal support to all the local authorities that we have within Scotland. There's more targeted support that they can give to local authorities that are most in need. So that might be one of the ways that they could do that, is through looking at the highest levels of poverty in an area, or in a dialogue with a local authority where that more targeted support has been identified either by Education Scotland or by the local authority. And of course, there's also intensive support that can be provided when we're seeing limited progress. So I think that one of the key aspects of Education Scotland work is to ensure that they're there for every local authority, but they're also there to be able to support, absolutely support, and work collaboratively with schools and with local authorities, but to challenge where necessary if they're not seeing progress that one might have expected through this.
And just for myself, because I'm fairly new to the committee, just to get a bit more specific about where that challenge happens, who's providing the challenge, what's the forum, where's it happening? Is it within the regional collaboratives, or what does it look like?
So it can happen in a number of different ways. The Regional Improvement Collaboratives is an important aspect to allow local authorities to work together, to collaborate and to share good practice and support each other through this. Education Scotland will be having numerous conversations directly with schools or with the local authority central teams, for example, to be able to look at the work that's going on. One of the areas I would point to within the work of Education Scotland is, of course, the 32 attainment advisers that are within the agency to be able to provide that support and, where necessary, challenge to a local authority. But it is very much intended to be a collaborative process. It is there to be a supportive process. I think I haven't met people within the education system that aren't wanting to see change, but there is an ability for Education Scotland, of course, to escalate those measures and to have further discussions with local authorities should they feel the need to do that.
And I suppose as well that, as well as the scrutiny at parliamentary level, local authority scrutiny from their politicians is important as well. As you said, this isn't just about government, this is about local authorities as well.
Well, absolutely, and we're very clear within the national government that we should work in partnership with local government where at all possible on many of these issues. But as I've also said, the work that we're doing, for example, around Stretch Aims is something that many local authorities were doing to some extent. What we're trying to do now is ensure that all local authorities are taking part in that process. And that there is a transparency around that improvement work. And of course, education is the responsibility of the local authority to be able to deliver. Those decisions are quite rightly taken at a local authority or indeed a school level. And there is a very much a responsibility on the local authority to challenge themselves on why there is a variation either within their local authority or to another local authority, just as you would expect the national government to be able to challenge itself on what's within its responsibilities to be able to target as well. But the role and responsibility of local government is, again, I hope, something that's very clear in the refreshed attainment challenge, where we set out the roles and responsibilities of the different parts of the system.
Thank you. That's helpful. Convener.
Thank you, Ruth. Michael Mara.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary, for the evidence so far. The Deputy First Minister told this committee on the 23rd of May 2018 that the utilisation of PEF for the replacement of a service that was there before was unacceptable and would be a breach of conditions of grant. Does that remain Scottish Government policy?
It's very clear that PEF funding is additional. I think the evidence that the committee has had from directors of education, for example, showed very clearly that that was the Director of Education's view on these issues as well, that the funding is additional.
OK, thank you. And so does the Cabinet Secretary then agree that where services have been withdrawn due to pressure on local authority budgets and schools maintain these services through PEF, that that constitutes substitution for cuts, would not be allowed?
Well, again, I would point to the evidence which I think the committee has already had from the Director of Education, where the Director of Education has said that priorities may change within a local authority, so a local authority may determine that priorities have changed within their area. Is absolutely their right to be able to do. A head teacher can then decide that they would wish to keep that service even if a local authority has changed its priorities. So a head teacher is able, as I think as has been amply demonstrated by the Director of Education that was talking about, that those things can happen, and that's the reasons why.
So I find that a little bit contradictory, if you bear with me, though, because I think this is actually a kind of matter of concern for people who are charged with implementing the policy on the ground, the head teachers, for instance. So if they see cuts to the Scottish Attainment Challenge money in their area, then you're now saying that you can use PEF money to pay for those services instead.
What I'm saying is, if a local authority decides to change its priorities at a local authority level, which of course would be under the direction of the local administration, if they decide to change priorities, then a head teacher can determine a project. But again, I would point not to my opinions on this, sure, but actually to the Director of Education, who I think gave an example of how that might happen.
You're referring to one of the 32 Directors of Education in Scotland?
Referring to one of the four who was sitting in front of the committee.
Absolutely. Yes, absolutely. So just to be clear, I've had conversations with other directors of education who perhaps feel less clear on this point. So I'm just trying to get clarity for them, if that's fair. So I refer to this report, which you won't have in front of you, which is a report from Dundee City Council. So Dundee City Council are dealing with a 79% cut in Scottish Attainment Challenge funding. So the report, which was on the 24th of January of this year, identifies 106 posts that have to be cut as a result of the £5 million reduction in funding from the government. We had Jim Thulis in front of us a few weeks ago, who is a former head teacher from Dundee, who said he was trying to understand how Dundee would cope, and he didn't think that they could on that basis. But the report says that posts that will no longer be centrally funded from this funding, schools can now procure their services if required. I think that backs up what you say. So using PEF money to pay for SAC cuts. Is that fair?
What we have made very clear through the process, as we've looked at the Scottish Attainment Challenge, is that we need to recognise that poverty exists in all 32 local authority areas, that we were very clear that we needed to work on a fair funding model across Scotland to ensure that we were delivering support right across Scotland. I believe yourself, Mr Mara, actually did say in a previous evidence session that you recognise that poverty exists right across Scotland.
Clearly.
So the Scottish Government has a responsibility to have a funding package in place that recognises that and provides funding to every local authority. So I think everyone agreed that there needed to be a fair model from that, and that's what we have delivered through the new funding allocations.
I don't think that's really an answer to my question, which is to try and get clarity for this. So what you're saying now is that PEF money in Dundee should, and it's possible to spend it, to backfill these cuts that you've made.
I wouldn't dictate at all how Dundee or indeed any other local authority will deal with education. That is for them to do. Yeah. But I think you've been given evidence, indeed, actually not just by one of the four directors that were in front of you, but by others, about the fact that there is a holistic approach to funding, that of course that local authorities will take their decisions on that, and a head teacher can use PEF funding if they wish to do so, following the local authority's decisions.
OK, I think that poses all kinds of other questions in terms of the multiplier effect of the cuts. But I think what you're asking us to believe in this, Cabinet Secretary, is that the way to give support to poor kids is to cut support for the areas who have the most poor kids. Is that correct?
So what we've actually seen is that 59% of children in relative poverty live outside the challenge authorities. So if we had stayed with the formula as it was before, we would be ignoring the 59% of children in relative poverty that actually are in other parts of Scotland.
And to be fair, that was your policy, Cabinet Secretary. It wasn't our policy, it wasn't my policy in terms of actually, you know, concentrating on ignoring those people. So it's good that the money is now available to local authorities. For instance, you know, Fife, you know, they are up £2 million under the new formula. Of course, over the last decade, they've lost £290 million in terms of cuts that you've made. So it's understandable that Fife Council welcomes that £2 million. But it doesn't really deal with the issue that I'm focusing on in terms of the levels of multiple deprivation and those challenge authorities that were picked on that basis. Deep poverty, huge barriers. I mean, surely, within this, you know, we're talking about this year just over £6 million, rising to £25 million over the course of this Parliament. Surely you can see it within the government's heart to put that money back. Surely. So, to protect those 106 posts. These people are speech and language therapists working with the absolutely poorest kids. And those are the posts that are under threat, for instance.
So what I would point to is the fact, of course, that the IFS have calculated that school spending per pupil is higher in Scotland than elsewhere in the UK, and indeed also that spending is 15.6% higher than in 2014-15 in real terms. So
Cabinet
we have
Secretary,
supported
that, the IFS's figures on percentages about England are pretty cold comfort to the people in Charleston and Dundee who are losing.
If you excuse me,
Cabinet Secretary, who are losing posts for people who work directly with their children. Can you address those concerns rather than those numbers?
You insinuated that there were difficulties with education expenditure overall in different local authorities, so I would merely point the committee to the actual education expenditure that we are seeing overall. But I think what we have very much looked to do is provide a fair funding formula for right across Scotland. So the allocations that were distributed to the nine local authorities were determined based on bespoke bids for resource rather than a data-driven approach. So we've moved to a distribution that recognises that poverty exists in every local authority in Scotland. And I would point to that 59% figure which I mentioned earlier. I would also point to, I think, one of the other directors of education, which was in front of you before, Ruth Binks from Inverclyde, who made very clear in her testimony that when we started, and I'm quoting, convener, when we started as attainment challenge authorities, we were very much told that we were pathfinders, looking at how to make things work. We were asked to adapt and adopt. That's what they did. And I think that's very important about the context that this was in. The invitation has been given to me to find the money, an extra £43 million within the education budget. There is not £43 million not being spent within the education that is sitting spare. So if the committee, if the member
would... The turnout figures for this year currently indicate a £20 million underspend. So would that not start? You know, this £6 million is the figure for this year. The turnout figures to be confirmed in June indicate a £20 million underspend in the education budget.
Well, part of the important area that we work with local authorities is we allow a roll-on for money to allow local authorities to be able to blend. But I would point again to the fact, you know, even if... Even if that £6 million wasn't still going to be used within education, that still leaves a very substantial gap. There is not £43 million unallocated within my education portfolio. So the difficulty, as with all of these things, if the member thinks that I should be spending additional money, should it come from early years education? Should it come from the fact that we took away core curriculum charges? Should I reduce the school clothing grant? It all has to come from somewhere, with the greatest respect.
Yeah.
£43 million pounds additional funding that I would put in.
With the greatest respect, I think I did identify the underspend there. If I can come, you cited some evidence sessions that we have had. If I can say that in regard to Inverclyde, we had a head teacher that said in evidence with us on the 9th of May that teachers are, and I quote, raging, and that the single thing that you could do to improve the system was to put back the biggest cut that would be the thing that would improve the scheme. Put back the cut that you are making. I can also just cite the evidence of Andrea Bradley, the EIS, saying they're absolutely appalled at the levels of funding cuts to the challenge authorities. It beggars belief. We do not understand why those cuts would be made at a time when we know that poverty levels are rising, when the pandemic has absolutely bludgeoned some communities, and we know that individual families and the young people within those families are struggling as a result of COVID. The NASUWT said it's clearly not right to be making these swingeing cuts. Jim Thewlis, School Leaders in Scotland, said it's immoral to take away that funding. So can you direct it to those communities directly? Are you prepared to apologise for the impact of this? If you're saying you're not going to put the money back, can you apologise?
The only way the money could be put back is if I took it off the other local authorities that would have it for the first time. If that's what the member is suggesting...
Well, then you're suggesting that I find additional money,
which I do not have. And, for example, the £6 million that you're quoting would actually take further PEF money from schools. So if you're suggesting that part of that way that we could actually allocate this is by taking that £6 million at current underspend that is in PEF that will still remain with schools, yeah, then I don't think that that's a sensible way forward. This allocation has been an attempt to ensure that there is a fair funding formula right across Scotland. I think there was an understanding, as again has been shown in some of the evidence from your directors of education, that we needed to look for a fair funding formula right across Scotland. I would, of course, point to the fact that this was also worked with and agreed by COSLA. So, yes, these are difficult decisions that government have to take, but the importance of ensuring that we recognise the poverty that exists across all local authority areas and that we dealt with that, and the impact of the COVID pandemic across all 32 local authorities led us to change the funding formula. There is not additional money within my portfolio that is not being spent, so it would have to come from somewhere else within my portfolio.
Your failure to win arguments with the Cabinet Secretary for Finance about your budget is frankly not just the concern we have here. And that's,
I'm afraid that's representations
we have from across the sector, not just secondary school, primary school, tertiary as well. I mean, I don't think we're going to agree, Convener, in terms of what's happening here. We're taking money away from the Scottish Government from the poorest communities and the poorest kids paying the cost of other kids in poverty across Scotland. Those kids require funding. But I just cannot agree that it has to come at the expense of the kids in the poorest community in this country. Clearly, the Cabinet Secretary does not rest on that.
Well, Bob Doris. With the greatest respect, then the member would suggest where the money should come from. And if it's not from education, what part of the budget it is.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. We're moving to Bob Doris.
Convener, thank you very much. I thought I'd entered into this afternoon's education debate early, Convener. I thought we were doing an inquiry into the attainment fund, but there we are. So I would like to look at a wee bit about measures of success and evaluation around that. I thought Mr Rennie had a really interesting line of questioning where he thought that progress in closing the attainment gap had not really occurred in any meaningful way. I'm going to put some statistics on the record, Convener, as I have done before, and then make a comment on them with a question to the Cabinet Secretary. 2 years before the pandemic, literacy was up 3.1% in primary schools and numeracy was up 2.7% in relation to the standards that were expected. The gap between school leavers from the most and least deprived areas achieving one pass or more at SCVQ level 5 or better reduced by 12.5 percentage points between 2019 and 2019-20. And last year, Convener, as you know, I was very proud to talk about a school in my constituency that had 100% positive destinations, St Rock Secondary in Royston, and record positive destinations in Glasgow and mostly across the country. Now, Convener, these statistics suit government and they suit the Cabinet Secretary. However, they are three indicators of a snapshot of progress, and they're the ones that might suit government. How, Cabinet Secretary, do we take a balanced approach to monitoring and evaluating progress? So is it the 11 indicators in the National Improvement Framework? Is there an agreed dashboard of progress that we can look at a national level, but also is the Convener wanting to get under the skin at a local authority level as well? Because having looked at some of the documentation around the attainment challenge evaluations and refresh, it's pretty hard going reading through it, Cabinet Secretary. So how do we get clear, transparent indicators or a dashboard, if you like, that allows this committee and the education sector in general to get a balanced view of how the Scottish Government is or isn't succeeding in addressing the attainment challenge?
So the important areas that we're looking at are within the National Improvement Framework and the work that is within that, the measures that are within that. We're obviously currently consulting on the measures within the NIF to ensure that the data that's being collected is the right one, are the right measures, so that we can ensure that we are collecting material that is useful to both government and teachers. When we're looking at the stretch aims, for example, that are coming out from local government, that will clearly look at core areas around numeracy and literacy, but it's a core plus model where the local authorities are also asked to look at wider areas around health and wellbeing to ensure that we are able to determine not just the impact on attainment, but the impact on other part of a child and young person's progress. But if I can perhaps bring in Graham Logan to talk about the dashboard, which is published, and the information within that.
Thanks, Cabinet Secretary. Yes, Mr. Dorris, the answer is we do publish data across the 11 core National Improvement Framework measures, and those 11 measures were developed after an extensive consultation to make sure we were taking a very balanced approach to looking at the attainment gaps. So it's not just literacy and numeracy, it's things like participation measures. It includes things like the 27 to 30 month review for the youngest children, so that we're identifying gaps as early as we possibly can. And that's published annually in December as part of the National Improvement Framework report. And we also, since the National Improvement Framework was introduced in the last Parliament, have more data on school performance than before. We have school-level data published against a number of these measures, which can be seen by parents and carers in terms of that school level and locally and nationally as well.
OK. And can I just check then, is that replicated across 32 local authorities? So we get a national flavour, but we'll skip to see any local variation that's there, because I know the committee's heard there might be different ways that local authorities collect this data and present this data.
Yes, so the National Improvement Framework includes analysis nationally and also includes a breakdown as well across local authorities. We're in discussion with local government colleagues, as the Cabinet Secretary said, in terms of the current consultation on the NIF measures, because obviously local authorities use some of these measures, they use some of their own measures as well, and we're particularly keen to look at the local government benchmarking tool as well to make sure there's as much consistency in the measures we're all using in terms of talking about improvement. But those 11 core measures, as I say, were developed after consultation, including with local government partners, to get that broad and balanced account of children's progress and development and in terms of closing the gap.
I think I would quite welcome this committee's obviously reporting, but this committee taking a view on how clear and readable those that dashboard is. And maybe that's something we'll look at within the report and that we'll return to. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, we met some teachers at St Rock Secondary School for the West Hub, and they were telling us that they were concerned that the impact of COVID would see some slippage back on progress made by young people, which was their primary concern, but there's a secondary concern that it would also negate a lot of the good work that had been taking place during COVID and before, and that might not be recognised because of that. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, therefore, Convener, whether there's an impact statement likely to follow every annual reporting process. So, for example, the impact statement could deal with the impact of COVID on how progress has been made, how other external measures, because it is the poverty-related attainment gap, so the impact of the £20 cut in universal credit, the impact of the UK cost of living crisis, or on a more positive note, the impact of the Scottish child payment, because there's massive monies at play, not just within education, but within wider public expenditure at a Scottish and UK level, which will impact on the poverty-related attainment gap. So, Cabinet Secretary, will there be an impact statement when we look at future evaluations?
So, when it comes to the impact of COVID, I would point Bob Dorris to two aspects. One is the equity audit that took place some time ago now, which looked at the impact of COVID and reported back on the impact of it. And also the most recent ASIL statistics which came out, which did see a dip in attainment. And it is very difficult to draw a direct correlation between one thing happening and an impact on attainment. But I don't think it would be stretching the bounds too much to say that clearly the impact on attainment that has been had over the past couple of years has been because of the impact of COVID. That was clearly shown in the equity audit. The context which Mr Dorris points to is exceptionally important and will be taken account of as Education Scotland works with local authorities on the stretch aims. So clearly the context of every local authority will be taken account of. And we will always ensure, as we are developing our policies, that we analyse the impact of those policies once we evaluate. Again, I would say it's very difficult to point to one policy having a direct correlation to changes in outcomes. But what is clear, for example, is that the more we can do to tackle child poverty, the more we will to help families in their overall circumstances that will help with attainment. And likewise, if there are decisions taken elsewhere, and Mr Dorris points to the £20 cut in universal credit, then clearly those will have negative experiences for families that inevitably will have impacts on how families can cope. So we will very much endeavour to look at the impact of different policies as we move forward and to take account of those and understand that context once the stretch aims are being developed by local authorities.
And convener, perhaps the Cabinet Secretary could write to the committee because of time constraints with my questioning this morning in relation to the positive destination data, which is quite exceptional this year. And again, please on record the efforts of teachers and students to get us to that stage. But we're all interested in, as the committee, what happens to those young people 1 year out, 2 years out, 3 years out. So it's lifelong learning in closing the attainment gap and making sure there's a positive impact on life chances. So a bit more information in relation to how the Scottish Government and its agencies tracks the journeys of young people once they have left school in a meaningful way where we can continue to track that data over a longer period of time would be very helpful. Convener, if the Cabinet Secretary or whatever officials could maybe deal with that in correspondence with the committee.
Yeah, they're nodding their heads. That's good. Thank you, Bob Dorris.
Thank you.
Oliver Mundell.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary. I wondered if you agree that high-quality teaching and learning remains the best way to close the attainment gap.
Well, it is one of the best ways to close the attainment gap. Tackling poverty is the other aspect, which is recognised in the refreshed mission that we have. So, yes, teaching and learning, but the reason why we've adapted the mission is to recognise the impact of societal poverty overall.
But you would recognise that without that core teaching and learning, you can put as many other things in place, but those young people are still likely to struggle when it comes to the more formal part of learning around literacy, numeracy and some of these metrics the committee have been looking at. Without that good teaching, we're not going to see improvement in those areas, are we?
Well, absolutely, yes. The teaching is an integral part of that, yeah.
So do you think we've got the focus and the balance right so far?
Well, one of the areas that we're very keen to look at in the Refresh Challenge is the wider impact of poverty, but the aspects around teaching and learning, one of the very key lessons that we learned from the first iteration of this funding and that we've very much held dear to over this is around the PEF funding going directly towards schools and an empowered system and being able to determine, for schools to be able to determine how that £520 million within this refreshed package will be felt. And that's because we place a very important place within our system on teachers and their role within it.
And you'd completely reject the idea that a lot of this money has been wasted. You're at a time when teacher numbers had been cut, when support staff had been cut, when there was a failure to reduce class sizes, and there's issues recruiting teachers in some subject areas and some parts of the country, and you know, in light of the fact that we still struggle to make teaching an attractive profession as seen by ongoing paying conditions, you don't think that there's a sense in which you know, we've spent additional money on things that are good, yes, but we've failed you know, when it comes to actually securing the fundamentals of the system?
I think what we've seen within the Scottish Attainment Challenge and with PEF funding in particular is schools putting in a range of programmes that they have determined, being directly involved with the young people, what's the most important thing that will make an impact on a child's health and wellbeing, which will obviously therefore set that child up within tackling any attainment challenges that we may have. I would,
I think most teachers say that teaching and learning is the core part of their job. And yes, they're concerned about children's welfare and they see that as being really important, but they feel they've been asked to do too much and that by not focusing on the area where they can make a difference in the classroom, you know, they feel we're seeing slow progress on literacy, numeracy, on these core you know, vital components for later education. Do you think that that's...
Well, I would reflect actually on a conference I was at only last week when I was asked by a teacher in the Q&A about the importance of looking at a whole child approach and the fact that actually it is impossible, and nor should we attempt to look at education somehow just looking at attainment and not looking at children's health and wellbeing. So I think it's very important, and indeed the feedback that I was receiving from teachers just last week was the importance of ensuring that we were looking at health and wellbeing and we were looking at other aspects. But I would, of course, point to the fact that we've got more teachers now than at any time since 2008. The ratio of pupils to teachers is at its lowest since 2009. There's over 2,000 more teachers in Scotland schools than before the start of the pandemic. And of course, we have additional commitments over this parliamentary term. So that, I think, shows that we are both investing in teacher numbers, but I don't think it's contradictory or in any way takes away from that to say that we should also look at a head teacher in conjunction with parents, with teachers, looking at how PEF should be spent to be able to support that young people. And that's a very clear part of the system.
Yeah. Well, I was also at a teaching conference last week, the SSTA conference, which I know there was no political representation from the Scottish Government at, and certainly the message there was that teachers feel undervalued, underpaid, under-supported, that our schools are under-resourced and that it's starting to have an impact on young people. But again, like other committee members, I don't think we're going to agree. So I'd just ask a specific question on PEF funding. Obviously, there's been a switch elsewhere within attainment funding to low-income families. Did you look at making that change in relation to PEF funding? And did you do any modelling on what that would look like in terms of the distribution of funds?
So the aspect around PEF, obviously, as I'm aware by your questioning, that you're aware that the decision has been taken to remain with the free school meals measurement for that. One of the reasons I was keen to
see that... Did you model what an alternative would look like based on low-income families?
Well, if I explain the reason why I took the decision to keep it within the free school meals was to ensure that there was a continuity within PEF from what schools had had previously to before. So the decision was taken very early on by myself to ensure that we were keeping that continuity within the system. Now, obviously, there will have been discussions and consultations about the Scottish Attainment Challenge in general before I came to that decision. I'm not aware of any modelling taking place within that, but clearly there was a number of discussions with stakeholders, with groups that were set up specifically to look at the refresh, where discussions will have been had on those areas. But I think that continuity was an important part of PEF that I was keen to continue.
And why did you feel it was worthwhile the disruption Mr Maris talked about in relation to other attainment funding? Why did you feel it was worth the disruption in terms of teacher posts going and support posts going in with that funding, but not worth looking at it when it came to PEF? What was the difference?
PEF already goes to 97% of schools, and it's important that we recognise...
It's not necessarily fairly allocated in terms of where the poverty exists if you're using a measure that is potentially flawed, is it?
Well, I appreciate there are different measures that we could use, but I've explained the reason why we've taken the decision to stay with that within PEF, and I've also explained the reason why I took the decision to change other parts of the system, and that was in the recognition that poverty exists right across Scotland and the fact that we are doing so not using SIMD or not using a bid process, which is what happened before, did allow us to look at children in low-income families that would help right across Scotland, including in rural areas.
Yeah, I think it's all a little bit inconsistent, but again, that's probably something to look at further as the committee thinks about the evidence we've heard. The final thing I wanted to ask whilst looking at attainment was really to highlight a challenge I've become aware of impacting a small number of Ukrainian young people who've settled in Scotland. There are a number of pupils who've joined too late in the school year to gain qualifications here in Scotland, and understandably they're struggling to complete assessments that they offer courses they started in Ukraine. And I just wanted to seek your assurance that this is something the Scottish Government would look at and work in partnership with local authorities, obviously to make sure that these young people are not further disadvantaged and that their future attainment isn't affected.
Well, I'd be very happy to either meet or Lord Mundell can send me the further details of the constituents he has in mind to be able to discuss this. Clearly, the Scottish Government is putting in support to assist with Ukrainian children and young people who come. It will be a difficult time of year to enter the education system, and that will understandably impact on what can be done within this academic year. There is a great deal of work going on between local authorities and then with individual schools about how to support particular families, because every circumstance will be different. But if there's a role that I can play in smoothing any of that over, or indeed Education Scotland can play in this, then we're very pleased to be able to do that. Clearly, for example, Education Scotland have put in national resources to assist with Ukrainian students and indeed families that are coming over, that are moving into the system. So there's a lot more just within the discussion about what we're doing within education to support Ukrainian nationals. But with the content of time, happy to take that offline to be able to deal with that.
Thank you.
Good. Single supplementary question from Michael Mara and then Graham Day.
Thank you. It is brief, Cabinet Secretary. Just reflecting on some of Mr Mundell's questions about the design of the policy. We put some questions to Education Scotland, I think they were with us last week, and I asked them whether they had raised any concerns about the impact on existing challenge authorities and the new formulation and how that was designed. And they said no, they hadn't raised any of those concerns. And I asked, did anyone else raise any of those concerns? And they said, not particularly. Do you recall those, just around the methodology design, were these things talked through? Or did you raise those concerns?
Well, I think clearly there was a discussion right initially about how we could have a fair funding settlement. And then what was discussed with stakeholders was what that fair funding settlement would look like right across Scotland. I think, again, some of the evidence that you've already had as a committee from one of the education directors, I think it was again from Inverclyde, talked about, well, of course she would prefer to keep all the money, but she recognised that a fair funding settlement was required. We did discuss the impact of that, as committee would expect, and that was one of the reasons why I made sure that there was a taper in place to allow changes in funding to be done not over 1 year, but over four.
OK, appreciate it. Thank you, Convener.
Graeme Day.
Thank you, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, I guess I'm one of the majority of MSPs in this Parliament who would welcome the funding that is going to the 23 other local authorities, very much welcome it, and reaching the 59% of youngsters who weren't previously being captured by this approach. But what I'm keen to get from you today is also perhaps an assurance around how the money will be accompanied by access to the gathered knowledge that we now have about what works. I was very, very struck by the sessions that we had with teaching staff from the west of Scotland. And I have to say, I found them incredibly positive about the work that's being done. But most of that knowledge has been amassed in the west of Scotland. Now, I know we have the regional collaboratives for sharing best practice. I'm just looking for a bit of assurance about how that best practice, that gleaned knowledge, is going to be available to the other local authorities who haven't had that opportunity up to now, other than through the individual schools and the PEF funding, so that we're not reinventing the wheel, that you can capitalise on the best practice that we know that works. And I guess within that is the question about the role of Education Scotland and all of that.
Yeah, so there was a publication by Education Scotland that was published around the same time as we launched the refreshed. Forgive me, I can't remember the name of the publication, but the point of the publication was to actually look at lessons learned, good practice, etc. Obviously within Education Scotland as well, National Hub looks at, again, good practice and discussions. And you point to the west of Scotland, RICs. Obviously, every local authority is covered by a RIC. And they are a very important area around collaboration as well. And it's perhaps a part of the system that doesn't get much discussion. It's understandably perhaps more national government and its agencies and local government, but the RICs do form a very important part of that information sharing and collaborative working. That was absolutely the intent behind the RICs when they were established, as well, of course, as the work that I've mentioned from Education Scotland. We have the attainment advisors that are there to advise. There's 32 for each one for each local authority, but they are aware of what's happening right across Scotland and can relate some of that, and also the events that go on. And I would point also to some of the points I made earlier around the support that Education Scotland that can provide, that's for every single local authority or indeed directly to a school, which can take that knowledge that's been gathered and been able to disseminate that for head teachers. But I think what we've been it's been good to see is that I would hope, in part because of the work of the RICs and of Education Scotland, we're seeing head teachers say that they feel confident and in a place to be able to implement policies using PEF that they feel will make a difference, so they're aware of the policies and that they feel confident they can take those forward. And I think I mentioned that in my introductory remarks, so I won't go through the specific stats of that. And the final part of that work in collaboration that is being done is work with Education Scotland and different local authorities around collaborative improvement. There have been a number of local authorities that have been through that process. Every local authority will go through it. It's work that's been done very closely in conjunction with ADES to again make sure that there's that continuous improvement in learning.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Kabir.
Thank you, Graeme Day. Ross Greer.
Thank you, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, I'm interested in the potential for some longitudinal study work on the impact of funding so far. I think it was Jim Thulis from School Leaders Scotland who first made the point to us that We're now at the stage of potentially having an entire cohort having gone through either the whole of primary or secondary education while these funds are in place, and that this is an appropriate time to do or to commission some long-term, longitudinal evaluation of the impact that the funding has had overall. So my first question would be, is there anything already underway or any work that is likely to take place over the coming months that would fit that description of a longitudinal evaluation of the overall impact that the funding has had in specific settings?
There's not the longitudinal work that I think Jim Thewlis was referring to when I've looked at the evidence that he gave. Clearly, there's a lot of evaluation work that has been undertaken, and we are in the process of finalising the evaluation work for the refreshed SAC. But I think it's an interesting proposal which has came up. I'm happy to give it further consideration and perhaps hear directly from Jim Thewlis. Of course, he can feed in on this and about the importance. One of the aspects I'm keen to make sure is we gather a lot of data on education within Scotland. There's data that's gathered by local authorities, that's data that's gathered as part of the NIF. And would this be a worthwhile exercise? And the query, obviously, within that is what impact it would have on teachers' workload, etc., etc. So we would clearly have to look at all those caveats about it as well. But it's something which I'm happy to go away and have further discussions on and see if there's a role for that. And, you know, in due course, I'll take a decision on it.
That's really good to hear. I think the last part of your answer probably points towards what the answer to this next question will be. But if such a piece of work was to be undertaken, where would responsibility for that sit? Would that be with Education Scotland? Would it be for Graeme and the directorate? I'm interested in the accountability around evaluation of the scheme overall, but if something specific, like a bit of longitudinal evaluation work, were to be done, where would that best sit?
I think I'd have to look at actually what we would want to achieve from that, and then that determination can take place. And clearly there'll be views about where that would best sit from stakeholders that I would listen to if we were going to take that forward. Clearly the responsibility for the evaluation sits overall with Scottish Government, but Education Scotland does play a very important role and will continue to play a very important role in the evaluation of that over the coming years.
In terms of Education Scotland's role, how much of that is about ensuring that RICS and local authorities are evaluating and feeding back up versus doing their own direct evaluation?
Well, one of the areas we were really keen to ensure as we went through the refresh, and particularly with the introduction of stretch aims, is that we weren't asking local authorities or schools to carry out work that they weren't already doing, because what we didn't want to do was put an additional burden into the system. So the way that the refresh has worked has been very much in collaboration with Scottish Government, and a determination about what could be involved in the stretch aims will involve things that are already part of a school improvement plan or a local authority's work. So that was very important to me as we looked at this, as we didn't put further pressure on the system at any time, but particularly at this time. And I think this is very important for national accountability, but I hope there will also be an ability to have that local accountability for the stretch aims and for what happens, as does happen within a local authority discussion at any time, whether that's through the committee or through elections or whatever. That importance of having that accountability at different levels is very important, but at a national level, it of course sits with me.
Just one final question on encouraging that local accountability. Obviously, it's not for the Scottish Government to tell local elected members what they should have on their own agenda, but how do you strike that balance between giving local authorities the autonomy they deserve as elected bodies, whilst trying to encourage and support them to do that kind of local evaluation work that can collectively feed up and build that national picture?
So I think there is an aspect that I have been heartened by in this position. I think there is an overall acceptance of the need to ensure excellence and equity in education. I don't think that's a national government thing. I think that's accepted by local government. One of the areas where we need to continue to look, both the national and local government, is what can we do in our different areas to actually see progress. Now, there will be some aspects that national government should be quite rightly challenged on. There are some aspects that quite rightly also sit within a local government focus about what they should be challenged on about doing more of. One of the aspects we've touched on today, for example, is around variation. Variation within a local authority, variation across local authorities. The data that we have does suggest that variation is marked. And if we can tackle that variation, it is again another lens to look at the poverty-related attainment gap, because it can't all be explained by different poverty levels in different parts of Scotland. I also think that there is a real desire and a determination within local government to be able to tackle the poverty-related attainment gap. You know, this is a shared endeavour between national and local governments, and it, of course, will be something which I will be very keen to meet my COSLA counterpart on when they are elected to their position, to be able to carry forward that discussion about how we can take that forward within our different responsibilities.
And just to clarify, where does responsibility for trying to reduce that variation lie nationally? Is it directly with government, or is it Education Scotland who would take a lead on that?
I think Education Scotland is a agency of government, so therefore the responsibility absolutely lies with me as the Cabinet Secretary. Education Scotland playing a very, very important role within this refreshed attainment challenge funding, around the support that is there, but also around the challenge where necessary. I am very keen to have a very collaborative approach, but there needs to be a little bit of a grit in the system if, for example, the work that Education Scotland has done with the local authority isn't delivering the types of progress that one might expect to see. And that's then a very much a responsibility of the local government to be able to discuss with that. But it is a collaborative approach. That grit needs to be in the system, but it's there only if that collaboration has not produced the changes that we would all like to see, at the pace we would like to see them.
Thank you. That's all from me, Convener.
Thank you, Ross Greer. Stephanie Callaghan.
Thank you, Convener, and welcome, Cabinet Secretary. Sorry, a bit of a cold today. Just going back a little bit, we've already spoken a bit about Ruth Bink's comments from Inverclyde about challenge authorities being pathfinders, and the fact that the workforce has really skilled up, and also their ability to manage PEF money growing year on year. We also found in our evidence as well that teachers were talking about really being able to reach into families and understand them better and understand the impacts of poverty. And also the teachers kind of independently reaching a similar understanding of what was actually working well for families, what had the most impact there. So my question to you is, would you consider that the Pathfinder funding approach was really successful? And what was it worked particularly well? Were there particular challenges? And then a kind of add-on question, I suppose, as well. We had Mr. Mara commenting about cuts quite a lot, which, if you're looking at it from the Pathfinder approach, isn't really what was going on there. But I'm wondering, you know, as well, he mentioned personal conversations that he's had, although that wasn't in committee evidence there. But I'm wondering, was it really clear enough from the outset that it was that kind of Pathfinder approach, or was that perhaps a learning point as well? Thanks.
Yeah, I think probably the easiest way to probably direct committee is actually back to the evidence that we've already had from the Directors of Education and Ruth Binks in particular, where she did very much talk about they were very much told that they were pathfinders looking at how to make things work. Clearly there is always a wish for funding to continue over a number of years, but I think that was clear, and that is one of the areas where the Pathfinders have been very successful, is to try out different models to ensure that they are looking at what works within their system, and for that learning to not only be within their own local authority indeed, but actually be learnt by others. So probably the easiest way to answer that is to point back to that evidence that was given by the Director of Education from Inverclyde when she was at committee.
And can I ask you as well, how will multi-year funding support better planning?
Well, one of the lessons which came across loud and clear, and it's not just in this part of government, but actually within different parts of government, is a wish for longer-term guarantees around funding to allow better longer-term planning. And that was something which came across, understandably, very much particularly from head teachers when they were wanting to plan out the PEF funding, part of the Scottish Attainment Challenge funding. That was something I was very cognisant of and something that we were very pleased to be able to deliver, and that will allow schools and local authorities to be able to do more long-term planning and to be able to ensure that there's a bit more continuity, for example, in the staff that are there for young people.
And just a final question, Convener. I think Mr Day made really important points as well around that collaborative working that's developed, that's really flourished, I suppose, as far as RICS at a national level, school and local level goes. Going back as well and looking at families themselves, they really seem to have had quite a bit of input and worked quite closely with teachers, etc. there too. And how can we make sure that we're continuing to have those families influencing policy and decision making, not just at that local level, but also at the national level too? How is it you intend doing that?
So obviously at a national or at a local level, indeed at an individual school level, there's the school improvement plan work and parents and indeed young people should play an important part of that. And we shouldn't forget the importance of listening to young people as part of that work as well. Within a national setting, we're very keen right across education to ensure that the voice of parents comes through in different parts of policy. So clearly we have connections either at official level or indeed at a ministerial level with parents' groups and hear directly from them, or they play an important part in, for example, the Scottish Education Council to ensure that they're involved in that part as well. So I think it is very important that while teachers know the young people best and we should have an empowered system, obviously part of the head teacher's work is to take account of the views of parents as they deliver school improvement work, and I think that's to the benefit of everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you, Stephanie Callaghan. Cabinet Secretary, thank you for the time you've given us this morning. As the convener of the Education, Children and Young People's Committee, I would have you here more frequently because I always enjoy your appearances before
the
committee.
As do I, convener, as do I.
I'm very pleased to hear that you enjoy them as well. But if, as is likely, we see you at least 6 months from now, how should we judge your performance as Cabinet Secretary in relation to this subject, the topic of our inquiry? Give me and the committee two or three things on your list of objectives that we can measure you against 6 months from now.
Well, I think 6 months from now we will have a fully refreshed system. We'll have the stretch aims in place. We will be able to have a discussion at that point, not in the abstract, but around those stretch aims. So I'll perhaps just make it easier and point to that one, convener.
Okay, that's fair enough. On that basis, I'll accept your list and we'll look to revisiting that in due course. So thank you again, not only to you, Cabinet Secretary, but also to Graeme Logan and to Alison Taylor for joining us this morning in committee. We wish you a very good day. And we will suspend now for 5 minutes to allow for a change of witnesses. Thank you. Welcome back. The next item on our agenda is an evidence session on the cross-border placements effect of deprivation of liberty orders, Scotland Regulations 2022. And this morning we'll take evidence from officials from the Children and Young People's Commissioner's Office. And so I'd like to welcome Nick Hobbs, Head of Advice and Investigations, and Maria Galley, Legal Officer, Children and Young People's Commissioner, Scotland. Good morning to both of you. The measure that we are considering is described by the Scottish Government. Thus, the current progress of placing authorities petitioning the Court of Session to recognise DOL orders cannot be sustained. It doesn't serve the interests of the child or young person at the heart of each application, and it places places a burden on local authorities and on the court itself when resources could be directed elsewhere. But you don't support this measure. Tell us why.
I think it's probably important to start, convener, by recognising that the problem that these regulations are directed at solving is we recognise not of the Scottish Government's creation. So we are sympathetic to the complexity of the issue that they're trying to address here. And we've seen that ourselves through intervention in a number of the cases that have come before the Court of Session and indeed the UK Supreme Court on these cross-border placements and on the use of the inherent jurisdiction to deprive children of their liberty. But the complexity of this issue is why it's so important that we get this right and get it right the first time. And our view is that what we need here is a coherent package of regulations that may span a number of different areas of law, including children's hearings, mental health and education, in order to ensure that these placements are only made in exceptional circumstances, that they're made where they are in the best interests of the child, that they're temporary in nature, and that they provide a clear parity of legal protection around the deprivation of liberty itself, but also around children's rights to health and education in terms of domestic law. So our concern is that the regulations are insufficient at the moment in terms of how they're currently drafted to provide that certainty.
You're looking for a more permanent solution, is that right?
We're looking for the regulations to be significantly strengthened, and you'll see that in the appendix of the evidence but that we provided to the committee that we've set out a number of ways in which that could be achieved.
But the government are saying that this measure is a temporary measure to meet the objective that I just read to you. Is that not real? Is that not reasonable?
It's absolutely reasonable to try and put in place something temporary with a view towards the Care and Justice Bill, addressing it on a permanent footing. But the Care and Justice Bill, in terms of implementation, is a couple of years away. So while this is a temporary fix, it's a fairly long-term temporary fix, and it needs to be robust. It needs to be compliant with Scotland's obligations in terms of the ECHR, the UNCRC, and other international law. And this package of regulations needs to be significantly strengthened in order to achieve that objective.
Okay, Ross Greer.
Thank you, Kinnear. If you don't mind, I'll start with a daft question because I'm certainly not a lawyer. One of your recommendations is that the High Court should only be able to make these orders for a maximum of 22 days and then a couple of subsequent potential three-month extensions. That's not directly relevant to these regulations, though, is it? That's either for the bill or more directly for the UK government and UK-wide legislation.
Well, we think you can ensure that these orders can only be made for a shorter period of time through regulations. You're right that a number of the issues here are about issues that are out with the direct control of the Scottish Government. And one of the things I think that we need to see from the government is some assurance from UK ministers that they are doing something to resolve the root of this, which is the lack of appropriate secure provision for children in England and Wales. But we can provide, in terms of the regulations here, significant additional protections for children's rights around the length of time for which an initial order can be made lawful in Scotland, around the units that can accept a placement, around the undertaking that can be provided by the English local authority. So the government does have some levers that it can pull to significantly strengthen the protections in Scotland.
I recognise there's certainly ways that the regulations can be strengthened. It's just that particular one around restricting the High Court's ability to, in terms of the length of the orders. It seems really questionable that we'd be able to do that through regulation in Scotland. At the very least,
any English local authority seeking to challenge that would have, I presume, a pretty strong case, given it's not in primary legislation in Scotland, and it's not relevant to the UK-wide legislation, that, or the English legislation specifically, that this is taking place in. But you mentioned a couple other concerns that I'm interested in getting into a little bit more detail on. So one of them that seems very reasonable is that by these regulations, the care inspector aren't actually obliged to inspect facilities. There's an obligation to notify them, but they're then not obliged to take any particular action. Given that this is a temporary solution, would you be satisfied if the care inspector simply made a commitment to do so, that even if they're not necessarily required by regulation, given that what we're talking about here is hopefully only going to be in place for 2 years, if the care inspectorate simply made a commitment to inspect these facilities, would that satisfy you in terms of that specific concern?
I think it's about two things. So the first one is about the distinction between a policy commitment and legal duties and obligations in terms of the ability to hold units and placing public authorities and Scottish public authorities accountable against particular legal duties. But it's also about how effective that's going to be in terms of securing the rights protections for children that we think are necessary. So we don't just think it's not just about the inspection itself, it's about the standards against which these units are inspected, and trying to provide that parity of legal protection that you would get if you were a Scottish child placed in a secure unit. So looking at the secure care standards, looking at some of the additional requirements that are in place for Scottish units that are authorised to deprive children of their liberty, and trying to provide that parity. But broadly, I think the concern is about trying to make sure that as much of this is placed in statute as possible. There's a care inspectorate report actually published this morning at 10 o'clock, so I appreciate committee members won't have seen it yet. But it very helpfully lays out a number of concerns about the care inspectorate's own powers, and about the issues that they've brought forward from consultation and a survey with their inspectors, in terms of what they've seen already, and the ability of the inspectorate and other agencies to hold providers accountable. And our view is that wherever possible, that needs to be in terms of a statutory duty, of a requirement, because that's what gives children the best level of protection.
Thanks. I think the concerns that I'm sure are in that care inspectorate report are certainly widespread, and I'm certainly not disagreeing with you in principle. What I'm trying to figure out here is, are we in danger of letting the perfect be the enemy of the good, particularly given that this is a temporary measure? Just a couple more specific points that you raised that I'm interested in getting a little bit of clarity on. So you mentioned that there's a line in your briefing here: there's a real risk that without sufficient legal restrictions, Scotland's opening the door to significant numbers of cross-border placements and to the possibility that this will be exploited by private profit-making providers. My understanding is that is exactly what's happening at the moment, and these regulations don't go far enough. I think the Scottish Government themselves would admit that, and that's why there's those proposals out for consultation at the moment in terms of the Children's Justice Bill. But surely what's proposed in these regulations would not incentivise further use of cross-border placements. It might not reduce it by as much as we want, but it would reduce it. Because, so for example, and I recognise that you've got some specific concerns with this point, but the regulations do give the Scottish Government the ability through the Sheriff Court to take action against the placing authority. Now, to me, that would be a disincentive. If I was an English local authority seeking to place a young person with a private provider who's based in Scotland, the potential for the Scottish Government to pursue me through the Sheriff Court would be a disincentive rather than an incentive. So do you recognise that the regulations maybe don't go far enough, but they don't incentivise further cross-border placements in Scotland? They do disincentivise them.
Just on your first points, and you talked about the perfect being the enemy of the good, and we absolutely agree with that. I think the concern is that we can't apply the appellation good to these regulations. They're not good enough at present. So we're not looking to make to create some sort of utopian legal position. What we're looking to try and make sure is that the regulations do the minimum necessary to discharge Scotland's obligations in terms of international law. In terms of your second question, I'll let Maria answer that in terms of the kind of the legal element of it. But I think what I would say is there are real questions about how that would work legally and about how effective it would be.
One of the main issues that we have a concern around is children's access to justice and children's rights to an effective remedy, to challenge these decisions, to challenge what is happening to them in being removed from their families and placed many hundreds of miles away often in an entirely different system, and then being deprived of their liberty and all of the rights restrictions that happen around there. There is nothing within these regulations that we consider would be good enough to allow those children to challenge that. So it's immaterial whether or not the Scottish ministers would be seeking to uphold the commitment made by the placing authority from England. I think there's a real difficulty in terms of rule of law, in terms of the Scottish ministers taking public authorities in England to court, and we might then enter into a little bit of a debate around constitutional law, around that particular remedy. But it's the absolute absence of the child's voice in any of this that's of most significant concern. So I think that a lot more has to be done. They aren't good enough, as Nick said. Absolutely, the minimum standards need to be achieved. Scotland has incorporated the UNCRC. We should be at least going to the maximalist approach that we can take in terms of rights protections within these regulations. We should not be making new law that allows children's rights to suffer in this way. And that's our principal argument against the regulations as they stand. There have been many concerns expressed across the legal profession around these particular issues about remedies, etc. And the court in England, the Supreme Court, raised a really interesting and important point. So the reason why these placements are inadequate, the reason why these placements are happening and children are being exported out of England into Scotland, not through our system. There is a mechanism. They could do it through our system, but they choose not to do it, and they choose to do it through this inherent jurisdiction of the High Court. And that's because of the lack of placements in England, lack of suitable placements. Scotland will be able to provide a better care service for English children, but it must be the same better care service that our own Scottish children are entitled to. There must be parity, and these regulations and this process and this procedure of what's been happening for 2.5 years does not give any parity or consistency at all for these children from England. So they're discriminating against the English children. So we need to see much more robust understanding of the child being involved in the decision-making processes. The cases that have gone to, that we're aware of, that have gone to the Court of Session to have the authorisation from the English High Court, those cases, and many cases have not been taken to the Court of Session. So the regulations in that sense would prevent an incentive to, if you want to, this placement to continue. But remember that many of the children are placed there before any legal action is taken, without any planning. Many of them are placed on an emergency basis. And the difficulty with the Court of Session cases, as we have seen, is that there have been no children represented since the initial case. None of the children are represented in the court. The court does not hear the voice of the child. That can't be right. That can't be right when we're incorporating the UNCRC into Scots law. So I think that that right to an effective remedy and participation is probably fundamental to this.
Sorry to interrupt. No. I have huge sympathy with so much of what you're saying there. I'm just trying to drill down and identify exactly each point of specific concern. Am I right in understanding from what you've just said, though, that you don't believe that these regulations would provide further incentive? So part of the question here, not all of it, part of the question here is, are we going to end up in a place where for the next 2.5 years we'll continue to see a significant increase in the number of placements? Do you believe the regulations make it more likely that we will continue to see that increase? Because that's the bit I'm struggling with here, particularly given, and I accept that it's questionable and we end up in a question of constitutional law, but particularly given the provision that's here allowing the Scottish Government to pursue the placing authority, to me that's a pretty clear disincentive if I was an English local authority to try for a placement that was in Scotland. So I'm still trying to understand why you think this process incentivises placement in Scotland.
There's two elements to that, I think. So the first one is, if you think about what the current process is, you have to make an application to the Court of Session. So you have to instruct counsel, you have to find Scottish solicitors. There's significant expense and legal complexity involved in that process. if we create a route whereby these orders are effectively automatically recognised, automatically transferred from an English order into a Scottish order, that's much simpler and much more straightforward. The question about whether the role of Scottish ministers provides a disincentive, I think, really comes to that question about how effective are these regulations in providing a route through which English local authorities could be held to account against their legal duties. Now, we've got the undertaking in there, but the undertaking's drafted pretty vaguely. And you'll have seen that we've made a number of suggestions as to how that might be strengthened. As Maria pointed out, it removes the right of access to remedy and redress from the child, which is where it should be, because the child's the one who knows best whether their rights are being respected, whether their needs are being met, and vests it with Scottish ministers. You know, there are real questions of practicality about how a Scottish minister is going to become aware of a child whose rights are not being respected in this place. How is a child expected to communicate that to, you know, with the best of intentions, a faceless group of individuals in Victoria Quay? How is the government going to assess whether those needs have been met? And then that's before you're even into the question about, in practical terms, what order could a sheriff court make against an English local authority? And that gets into the constitutional bit that Maria has talked about. So in practice, this is probably goes to the nub of one of the major concerns we have about these regulations. And we talk about it in our paper, is that they provide what appears to be significant rights protections. But actually, once you drill down to it, once you start to ask the questions about, in practical terms, how is this going to work, you're left with a lot more questions than answers, and that protection can appear quite illusory, and I think that's the case in this instance.
Thank you.
Graham Day.
Thank you, Convener. And I guess my question is about the interaction and relationship between the Office of the Commissioner and the Scottish Government. Because listening to this today, there seems to be quite a lot of blue water between your position and that of the Government. So can I ask, has there been any dialogue at all, any discussion, while these regulations were being put together between the Office of the Commissioner and the Scottish Government?
Yeah, so we've engaged extensively with the Scottish Government right the way through this process. So going back to the very first case that we became aware of some three and a bit years ago, and we've been talking to both policy and legal officials about their consultation process, and then most recently last week, about these regulations themselves. So we've had a detailed conversation with officials about the amendments that we've proposed and the request that we have for the Minister to withdraw these regulations, to reconsider them, to strengthen them, and then to bring them back to the Parliament so that they provide the robust and effective children's rights respecting solution that we all agree is necessary. So you talked about clear blue water, but actually in terms of policy terms, in terms of policy intents, in terms of the principles that we want to see applied here, we are absolutely in alignment with government. The difference between us at the moment is about what's necessary in order to achieve that policy intent.
But to be clear, the conversation about these proposals only took place last week after they had become public.
Well, we could only have a conversation about the regulations once the regulations were public, because we didn't know what they looked like.
So that's my point. You weren't having a dialogue before that about what would look like progress in this area.
Only in terms of the consultation, which was obviously kind of set at a level above the detailed regulations.
Okay, one final question, my mate, Kavira. You talked there about the opportunity for the child to challenge, but surely that challenge would lie with the placing authority. So the challenge ought to be between the child and their representatives and the placing authority. It wouldn't lie in Scotland, would it?
Well, this is one of the questions that the regulations and this issue really raises, is that really complex interaction between two legal jurisdictions. So the child is placed by the English local authority, and the English local authority retains all of its responsibilities and duties to meet that child's needs, and in terms of the regulations would be to pay for the services the child requires. But that's without prejudice to the existing Scots law duties that public authorities, so local authorities, health boards, etc., have to a child in their area. So the requirement to conduct a child in need assessment in terms of the Children in Scotland Act would still apply to the Scottish local authority. You get into issues about additional support needs, about mental health. It's a really challenging and kind of complex area. And there might well be a situation where what the child wants to challenge is actually the failure of a Scottish public body to respect their rights in terms of Scots law. Or indeed, they might need advice on their rights in terms of Scots law because that's not being respected by an English local authority. So this is we can maybe talk a little bit about additional support needs, because I think that's maybe the area in which within education this is kind of thrown into sharpest relief. So maybe I'll ask Maria to just touch on that.
Yes, absolutely. All of the children that we're aware of are all autistic. All of the children are teenagers. They have complex experiences of trauma and adversity in their childhood. These are children that we are very well aware of, their peers and counterparts in Scotland. And they have, all of them, as far as we have seen, are not having their education needs met. And they're not having an additional support for learning needs met in terms of the obligations of the state in Scotland. This is hugely concerning, because if they don't have a coordinated support plan, if they don't have a needs assessment to identify exactly who they are and where they're from, if they don't have mental health assessments, they don't have access to mental health services here, and the services all align in terms of the Scottish framework for decision-making and assessment, which is laudable in Scotland around the Getting It Right for Every Child framework. The national practice model allows that to happen in Scotland for every Scottish child. This is not happening for these children. So they are really falling between the cracks in terms of access to services, mm-hmm. having their needs met.
And you don't believe that the element of an access to advocacy services would be a step forward?
Advocacy is certainly welcome. There's no dispute or no disagreement about the value that a good advocate can bring to a child, and having a Scottish advocate in addition to their legal right to an English advocate is not a concern for us. The issue is that advocates aren't legal representatives. So an advocate's role is to help the child speak, but the advocate may not have the detailed legal knowledge to let the child know what their rights are and how to secure remedy or redress when those rights are being violated.
Okay, thank you, Convener.
Willie Rennie.
I can understand, this has been really helpful, by the way, I understand about equality between English children here and Scottish children here. I get that. Is there something particular about the equality between English children here and English children in England? And you say that these proposals are not compatible with the new NCRC or the ECHR. Is that the case in England as well?
Probably. It's not our place to comment on English law and its compatibility. But I think what we can stress and emphasise is the significant absence of available, suitable, rights-respecting accommodation in England for these children with the highest and most complex needs. So that gap, that missing link in the chain of rights protections for children in England is what is causing this situation in Scotland. So as far as we can comment on the English provisions, whether they're compatible. But certainly these provisions are not compatible, and in many cases, nor is our existing system. The Children Insecure could argue that some of their rights are not being met. But if you do a comparison between a child who's in secure accommodation in Scotland and who's in these privately run children's houses in Scotland and being deprived of their liberty, if you do a comparison, there is the blue water that exists between it. It's absolutely significant. And what we want to see is that any regulations that are to fix this gap will provide those necessary safeguards for the English children on the same level as the Scottish children. All the work's been done in Scotland. Scotland is there in terms of a rights-respecting approach that's been, fostered and promoted by children and young people themselves. The independent care review and the promise is being implemented in Scotland. We want to see the same thing happening for English children if they come here.
And just going back, though, are English children who are here worse off than English children in English facilities?
It would probably be on a case-by-case basis that you'd have to draw those comparisons. For example, it might be in a child's best interest to come here to Scotland and to be deprived of the liberty to receive those intensive supports. But this is not the way. We can't take a blanket approach. It has to be on an individual child basis to meet their individual needs.
And finally then, are you optimistic that the government will come to an agreement with you on the best way forward?
We're certainly hopeful.
I think it very much depends on the view that the committee takes today. You know, we'll look forward to hearing the minister's evidence next week, and I'm sure we'll have further conversations with officials on this after our evidence session.
Fine, thank you.
The Supreme Court ruled that the deprivation of liberty was in line with human rights, did it not?
The Supreme Court in the particular case, so that was the T case, was the kind of seminal case from last year. And what the Supreme Court was looking at there was, because of the absence of suitable provision, in terms of policy, the Supreme Court criticised the fact that there was an absence of provision and essentially reluctantly agreed that children could be placed in alternative provision that was unregistered, that wasn't secure accommodation in England. Now, bearing in mind that secure accommodation in England is entirely different, it's an entirely different enterprise and facility than secure accommodation in Scotland, but sometimes people think they're the same thing. They're not. So because of the absence of the significant and horrendous absence of suitable placements, the Supreme Court said that this has to be fixed. This has to be fixed politically. We have to see resources increased. We have to see greater protections for children's rights in England. But in the meantime, in emergency situations where children are absolutely at crisis point, life-threatening crisis point, then places to keep them safe can be authorised. But as I say, it was very reluctantly that they did that.
They didn't
address the question of cross-border placements.
Ruth McGuire.
Convener, colleagues have probably covered the areas I was sort of thinking about. I did want to ask about the policy intention of the advocacy. I guess I'm feeling a little bit confused in terms of I care about all children in all countries. I'll just say that at the outset. It's that bit about how we influence what's happening in England if the standards aren't being met there. And with the best will in the world, if we don't make the changes, it doesn't stop the children being placed. The changes that are being proposed have the addition of the advocate in there so that the child's rights are better supported and their voice can be heard. I think I just, and this might be a silly question, so just, but I'm going to ask it because it feels like an important topic. What about, how does us changing this help the practices in England, which you're saying don't seem to be rights-based? Can you just lay that out for me so that I can understand that?
Yeah, absolutely. So you're absolutely right that that there's limited ability for the Scottish Government or the Scottish Parliament to impact on practice or law in England through regulations made and laid before this Parliament. The ways in which you can do that, though, so these regulations obviously provide for a mechanism through which an English order is allowed lawfully to be transferred into a Scottish order. So you can place restrictions around the circumstances in which that can happen, and particularly around, for example, a restriction around a Scottish residential unit being prevented from accepting a placement except in where certain kind of criteria are met. So that's what we've tried to do with the amendments that we're suggesting, is absolutely to recognise that kind of tension, that challenge, but to find ways that are within the competence of the government and the parliament to provide some safeguards around this. So the restriction on which unit can accept a placement, strengthening the undertaking that the English local authority provides, providing access to legal representation in Scotland, you know, all of those things go towards within the powers that the Parliament has, providing additional human rights protections in terms of this. You know, the Parliament can't require the UK government to produce more secure units. It can't place direct obligations on the High Court to behave in particular ways, but we can restrict the route through which those orders are translated into Scotland in a way that provides additional rights protections for the children who are coming here.
And what would that mean for a child in England?
So it would mean, for instance, that we in Scotland would be able to have more confidence that there had been proper planning and consultation between the placing authority and the Scottish local authority. It would mean that the there was a jointly agreed, in terms of our amendments, jointly agreed care planning meeting between those two local authorities, where it's agreed what the child's needs and rights are and who's going to meet them. It would mean that the child was much clearer about what their rights are in Scotland. It would mean the child was able to contribute to those conversations and those processes. There's a really interesting point of comparison, I think, which is that if an English local authority is placing a child into another English local authority, there's a legal obligation on them to conduct a consultation and a meeting within 5 days of doing that so that they can agree exactly those issues. Now, we don't have that. There's no legal obligation on them to do that when they're placing into Scotland, but these regulations could be drafted in a way that makes sure that meeting happens. And that's the kind of amendment that we're suggesting here.
And I appreciate that you've already said that the Children's Care and Justice Bill is the place to properly kind of sort this out, and I think we'd all agree that deprivation of liberty needs to be a bare minimum and only in absolutely essential cases. Just it kind of follows on from what Ross was asking, but just again to be clear in my mind, the status quo isn't going to stop cross-border placements from happening, and do you agree that it won't decelerate the cross-border placements either, the status quo as we have it?
I think a really important thing to remember in all of this has happened before. So before, in terms of secure accommodation cross-border placements in 2017, there had to be an agreement between the UK government and the Scottish government that English children could be placed within secure accommodation in accordance with our statutory framework. It happened then. It happened as a temporary fix. It happened to resolve the situation that was happening down south with the increasing absence and lack of resources down south. So it's exactly the same as has happened now, but we're now in a much worse position. So when that happened, there was an agreement that the orders from England would convert into compulsory supervision orders in Scotland with authorisation for secure. That would then mean in Scots law, children could only be placed, deprived of their liberty, in secure accommodation. And that's been the existing situation. Now, what has happened since then, and what we are hugely concerned about, is the sunset clause that was supposed to take place. There was supposed to be a review of those placements from 2017. That, as far as we know, has not happened. What we have seen is an exponential rise in the number of English children being placed in our secure accommodation. And that has had quite devastating consequences as a result for Scottish children in Scotland who have not been able to access secure beds. Now, that's a separate issue, an entirely separate issue, but I think we have to learn from the difficulties that happen, because as soon as we authorise and condone this practice of moving children far from their families and communities, then we could absolutely see it. The disincentive that is required is to say Scots law does not allow these types of placements to operate at all. And if you want to comply with Scots law, then you have to raise the standards up to what we expect for Scottish children.
Thank you, that's helpful.
Thank you.
Graham Day. Thank you for indulging me. I'm looking at your proposals, your amendments, and a lot of them make perfect sense in the context of the legislation that's coming down the track. But in a practical sense, I want to pick up on one point, and this is not a hostile question, please. You talk about that any care home accepting young people must be registered, regulated and inspected by the care inspector as a care home for children and young people, and has a recent adequate inspection report. Now, we would all agree that that would be a fundamental. But that isn't practical at the moment, is it? Because we're still in the pandemic. There will probably be a backlog of inspections of these places. So in actual fact, what you're proposing with the best of intentions could actually make the situation worse. Because if those homes, or if there were insufficient numbers of homes that met that particular criteria, then there would be an issue about where to place these children full stop, would there not?
What we're trying to avoid with that provision is the situation that we've seen in England and Wales. So within the context of how the care system works there, you know, a lot of local authorities having divested themselves of their care homes, a lot of private providers having moved into that space, children in care very much being seen as a commodified resource. Mm-hmm. And what we've seen there over the last few years is, because that's seen as an area for people to secure profit, care homes popping up like mushrooms, being inspected 6 to 9 months later, being immediately closed down because the inspection reports, quite frankly, will give you nightmares. At which point we know that there's been a child there for a significant period of time who's experienced, you know, sometimes quite horrendous experience. So that's what this suggestion is trying to mitigate against, is to try and make sure that we are confident that we're only placing children into provision that is that can meet their needs. Welcome the Scottish Government, you know, having a kind of further conversation about that. You know, you could talk about what does recent mean, you know, in terms of what kind of time period we're talking about. But I think we do need to try and make sure that we have a level of confidence that when we are authorising and allowing children to be placed into residential units in Scotland to be deprived of their liberty, which is the most significant kind of human rights interference that the state can take in the life of a child, that we are making sure that these units are of a kind of minimum standard.
And you're right to do so, absolutely, but do you recognise the risk, if that was accepted, that we could have fewer opportunities than are required to place these children now?
It might restrict the supply, certainly, but we would argue that the balance of risk there is a necessary consideration in terms of taking a rights-respecting approach.
Okay, thank you, Convener.
May I just add something to that? Sorry. Just as Nick mentioned earlier, the Care Inspectorate have published this report, and it's hugely welcome and it answers this question.
Okay.
So they have undertaken an inspection and a review of these placements over the last 2.5 years, and they've made a number of recommendations and proposals to the Government and to themselves as to how to improve the inspection.
And just to be clear, what would you consider to be recent?
From my point of view and looking at what the Care Inspectorate have been doing during that time, it would have to be within the last 6 months. The difficulty that we have seen is that places are popping up.
Mm-hmm.
Places are being registered as care homes, which is absolutely fine, perhaps being regulated and authorised as care homes, but they're not meeting the standards that would be required for secure. Yeah.
Ross Greer.
Thanks, Convener. Just to bring together 2 points that Nick just made there that I think are perhaps related to, you said a couple of moments ago, there's a question about the connection between the young person and Scottish ministers if it came to that issue of should ministers pursue the placing authority. How would they know to do that if the young person's not got any connection with them? I think that's related to this question of the role of the advocate, and I completely accept what you're saying about that an advocate is not a substitute for legal representation, and there's complications there because these are young people who, if they do have a lawyer in the first instance, it won't be a lawyer who practices Scots law in almost all cases. But is there not a potential role for the advocate there? If there's a question of how do you create that connection between the young person and Scottish ministers for the use of that potential power to pursue through the Sheriff Court, could that not be addressed through guidance for those independent advocates? That is part of their role in advocating for the young person is, if they believe in discussion with the young person that it's necessary, if the young person believes it's necessary, part of their role is about creating that connection with ministers, with Scottish Government, to see whether that option of pursuit through the courts is a viable one.
The advocate can certainly play a role in terms of that. You know, the advocate's role is to elevate the child's voice within proceedings and within meetings and discussions that the child's involved in. The issue, and without, as I've said, advocates play a hugely valuable role, but advocates won't necessarily know what the child's rights are in terms of Scots law. And the child, one of the things we keep referring to a report that I know members haven't seen, which is a little unfair, but one of the things the Care Inspectorate report flags up is that children very often arrive in Scotland with very, very little awareness of their rights in English law, let alone in Scots law. And these are the most acutely vulnerable children. So they're, I think, relying on an advocate to provide that level of safeguard and that link to ministers, while they can play a role, isn't sufficient in our view.
Thanks.
Hook up, Stuart.
Thank you. It's been really interesting what you've said so far, and I think that you know, we've all more or less accepted that the Scottish Government's in a really difficult position about this. And, you know, you want to keep these kind of orders to an absolute minimum and as close to home as possible. So any indication of what kind of work you've done with the UK Government? Because obviously what has driven this is an under-provision in England. So have you lobbied the UK Government? How have you got on with that?
We've been in close contact with our sister offices in England and Wales and with legal and human rights organisations in both jurisdictions. So, in fact, and I should have said it at the start, the position that we've taken in relation to these regulations was informed very, very strongly by a roundtable that we conducted shortly after the regulations were published. And that involved Children's Commissioner's offices, it involved advocates, it involved solicitors from both jurisdictions, it involved human rights organisations. And the view reflected in that roundtable was absolutely unanimous about the about what needs to change around the regulations and how strong they are. It's the Scottish Government that we need has the contact with UK government ministers that needs to be making that kind of argument for additional provision. You know, it's out with the mandate of the Children's Commissioner in Scotland to be telling the UK government how to set up its own care system. You know, our sister office in England has been very, very strong on this over the last few years. They've conducted a lot of research. The previous Children's Commissioner was very, very vocal about it. The courts in England have been very, very vocal about it, both in terms of the High Court and the Supreme Court. Lady Black, again, in the Rees-Tee case, referred to, you know, matters having been brought repeatedly to the attention of those whose job it is to do something about it. So this is not an issue the UK government is unaware of. But you know, what we have in front of us now are Scottish regulations, which are very much within the mandate of the Scottish Children's Commissioner to comment on and to effect.
Okay. So there's no sort of like scope for, I mean, we have the Education Committee here and you're here in front of us. So is that a route to actually, you know, the Education Select Committee at Westminster? Because obviously it's ministers that are going to make that decision, aren't they? So it's to get to them.
We're very happy to provide evidence to the Education Committee in at Westminster about this. And I think it's an issue that has come before the Parliament down there. As I said, this isn't a new issue. Mm-hmm. This is something the courts and the Children's Commissioner in England have been lobbying on and advocating for some years now.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Gavin.
Yeah, I'm sure my good friend Robert Halfin will be very pleased to hear from you and from others. Does any other member of the committee wish to say anything at this point? Well, thank you to Nick Hobbs and Maria Galli for being with us in person to give this very important evidence to the committee.
Thank you.
Wish you a very pleasant rest of the day. The public part of today's meeting is now an end. We will now consider a final agenda item in private. And so can I ask members attending virtually to reconvene on Microsoft Teams. And thank you, and a good morning to everyone.